where we're at, if you haven't turned to already, we're in the book of Esther. So if you could turn with me, the book of Esther. The events of Esther covers a period about 12 years. 12 years that we'll be looking at, and it's a very fascinating book. It gives us the historical setting of the Jewish feast called. What's the feast called that we celebrate? Purim. Yeah, you guys, some of you guys know of this feast. I've been over Israel when they have the Feast of Purim, and it's something to see. The Jews even celebrate it to this day, and of course, they celebrate in the 12th month of the Jewish calendar. That's really equivalent to March. And so if you're over in Israel, Jerusalem in March, you're going to see all these little girls running around town dressed up like Esther. And then you'll see Haman, and they'll make these little cookies that they call the ear of Haman. And they pass it around, and they have a great old time during the month of March. You know what's interesting about the book of Esther as we read it? Even though and it's the only book that you find that the word God is not mentioned. You won't find God as you go through there, but his handprint is certainly in the whole book, as you go through. What we can see how God is preparing in advance what he knows is coming. And that's a theme that we see throughout the Bible. And if you take a snapshot of it in the book of Esther, how God is preparing in advance what he knows is coming. Even as we were talking before service tonight, as we were talking about the worlds of events that are around us and how we know that those things are happening for a reason, right? God is preparing, I believe, for the world events in front of us for the rapture of the church. God is always in the work of preparing for the future. Our problem, of course, is that we don't know what the future has to hold personally, and we are prone to judge the entire story of our life so often, or somebody's life, if there's one bad chapter. You ever read a book and you get a bad chapter? Like, I'm going to throw the book out. I don't want to read it. Maybe you're one of those who like to read the last chapter of the book, and then you'll go back and read through it. Well, you know what? I've read the last chapter of the book. It's pretty exciting, isn't it? See, God knows our future, and he lays out the events that's going to be happening, and he wants to tell us, and he certainly wants us to know what's going on according to the events of the Bible. The book of Esther, we have an interesting insight into the background. Once you know the full story of Esther, of course, it takes a lot of the drama out. But if you've never read Esther and you've never, seen a play on Esther, you're ready for a very, exciting time. As we'll see the events going on, you know what the whole story of Esther is all about? It's about this move, I believe, of Satan to try to really exterminate the Jews. And if they could exterminate the Jews, there'd be a big problem, wasn't there? Wouldn't there? Because who's coming, who's going to be born the king of the Jews is Jesus. And so we see that come throughout. And as God works in our lives, sometimes the things that God is doing in our lives today, don't they also often, we don't really see them take place maybe 5 years or 10 years or 12 years down the road, we don't really see it happening today. That's what we'll see in the book of Esther, how time transpires. Time goes by before we see the event where God is using Esther. Esther's one of those, I say, heroes of the Bible. So often we think of David, we think of Abraham or Moses, but I put her right there too, in that same place, because there was a time for her to step up to the plate, to step up and do things that are right before the Lord, and she did it. It's an exciting thing as you take a look at it. And as we opened up in chapter 1, verse 1, we read, "Now it came to pass in the days of Ahasuerus," that is Ahasuerus, "which reigned from India even unto Ethiopia, over 127 27 provinces," really what he has there. If you can picture in your mind, this is probably one of the largest empires that there ever was, especially during the ancient world, where it went from India all the way to Ethiopia. when he says these provinces, they're countries, really, really what he's talking about. When you look at a huge map, what they had, they released the state of California, all these different places that he reigned. When Darius, remember Darius and Cyrus were kings of Persia? Persia at that time had 120 provinces, as you read it. Well, they had increased it as that took place, really, as we'll see later on in the book of Daniel. But on the chronological timelines, Darius and Cyrus has already moved off the world stage by this time. And, of course, we know that Ahasuerus, and his secular's name is Cyrus, as if you ever know that, or Xerxes, they like to call him. So in verse 2, we see that in those days when the king of Ahasuerus sat on the throne of his kingdom, which was in Shushan, the palace. Where he was staying there, of course, it would get very hot. If you had a summer palace that was in the cool and shade, where were you going to spend your summer? Up at the summer palace. And so that's where he went. It says, in the third year of the reign, he made a feast unto all of his princesses and his servants, and the power of the Persia, Medes, the nobles, and the princes, and the provinces being made for him. And so the third year of his reign, so we mark that, and we know the time. In the third year of his reign, that particular incidents took place, as we see here, when he showed the riches, verse 4, and of his glorious kingdom, in the honor of his excellent majesty, many days, even 84 days. And when these days were expired, the king made a feast unto all the people that were present at Shushan and palace, both unto the great and the small, 7 days in the court of the garden of the king's palace. And so the nobles were brought from all the 127 provinces, all, you know, across the known world at that time that he controlled, all the governors you might think of, and they're probably their wives, their families, everybody traveled to go see the king, and they made this great feast for really what it was 180 days they were partying. That's a long time as they gathered there, as they were feeding everybody. Why did he want to do that? This guy was so wealthy, so powerful, that he wanted to show everybody. He wanted to show off all those things that he had. And so everybody came to this huge banquet that just never ended. And he would just continuously had all of his wealth shown to everybody. According to Herodias, the historian, it was one of the wealthiest of all empires known to man. Even the Egyptian empires we think of so often, it really could be compared to their wealth was to what the Medes and the Persians had accomplished at this time. Finally, when Alexander the Great, remember when he went in there in his great battles in order to conquer the Medes and the Persian? After he got there, and it's a fascinating story on a side look at Alexander the Great, when he finally conquered this huge empire, he became the wealthiest man in the world, and it took the fight right out of him. He really never did do much after his great conquest there. The feast lasted a long time, and after they had this, they had 7 days continuous where everybody participated. Notice in verse 6, where were white and green and blue hangings, fastened with cords and fine linen, purple to silver rings and pillars of marble. And the beds were of gold and silver, upon the pavement of red and blue and white and black and marble. The floor, the mosaic they must have had, this beautiful marble and everything was beyond gaudy, per se. You know, I think, I don't know if you guys ever gone up to Morro Bay or up to San Luis Obispo up there, but there's this hotel, there's one, oh, I forget the name of it, that sits up at, what's it? The Madonna Inn, you know, and you think you can go into a room and maybe get one of these guys' rooms, how gaudy it was, but everybody got it. This was not that fake painted or gold leaf stuff they put on things. This is real gold and real emeralds and everything. And they went in and it was decked out. And they had these curtains to quarter off different sections of groups. Basically, you know, like I said, they were different languages that were coming out from his empire, different, you know, races and groups that were stretched all the way from Ethiopia to India. And so he had them all, you know, kind of in their own areas. And they gave them drink in vessels of gold, the vessels being delivered one from another, the royal wine in abundance accorded to the state of the king. And the drinking was accorded to the law. None did compel, for so the king had appointed to all the officers of his house that they should do according to every man's pleasure. Like if you were a guest there, you know, I like that alcohol you just served me. Could you keep bringing it? And so the idea is that these guys could get anything they wanted, and he just would keep pouring it upon them. Also, Vashti, it's pronounced many different ways, but we'll call it Vashti for our purposes. The queen made a feast for the women in the royal house, which belonged to King Ahasuerus. Otherwise, she had all the women with her. On the seventh day, when the heart of the king was merry with wine, he commanded Merimam and Bistha and Harbadon and Bigtha and Abitha and Zithar and Carcass and the seven chamberlains that served in the presence of Ahasuerus the king to bring Vashti, the queen, before the king with the crown royal to show the people and the princes for her beauty, for she was fair to look at. He says, you know what? I'm showing off everybody. They're seeing all my gold. They're seeing everything that I have. Look at everything that I have. Why not show off my best, my wife? She's beautiful. You know, and really at this point, as we see how they all were drinking, the king was probably more likely a little drunk, and he wanted to show off his wife. Now, in that culture, it wasn't proper for a woman to go out any place without what? A veil covering her face, even to this day. You know, over in the area of Persia and all that area, even to this day, freedom for women really didn't come into play until the gospel came, where women had the freedom to do whatever they want to, and they certainly should, and I believe that 100% as the Bible teaches that. But in this story, of course, we know that the king was asking her to do just to come over that she might display her beauty and kind of walk around, you know, kind of like, some model or something and show off to everybody. But the queen, in verse 12, but the queen Vashti refused to come to the king's commandment by his chamberlains, but therefore was the king very wroth and anger burned in him. You know, it's really sad when people drink, you know, and they lose their sense of judgment. I'm not saying that this is a message that for the Christian church that people will be watching this later and, you know, then nowadays, the thing is, it really broke my heart when I was hearing where churches and pastors were having board meetings, and at their board meetings, they were drinking. And they were having basically an open bar, and they thought it was okay. And that really troubled me, and it troubles me to this day that men and women in leadership, you know, Paul tells us that we need to be an example. He told that to their Timothy. We need to be an example to the believers or to each other. And here we see what happens when somebody drinks. And then you guys all know the story. You've known it. And I know some of the Agape Chapel have come out of drinking. You're not the same person that you normally would. You would say things and do things you don't normally do. Paul exhorts us greatly. He says, be not drunk with wine, but but be what? Be filled with the Spirit. I'm a person, and I believe we all have decisions to make in our life. And as a young man, probably at this time 17 years old or 18 years old. I had already moved out. I moved out on my own when I was 17. And I was moved over to Santa Ana, and I had a roommate with me that was working construction. He was a new believer, and I was starting to teach Bible studies when I was 18. I started at real young, started teaching campus life, and some of the teenagers wanted to come on over, some of the kids I was teaching, and they wanted, you know, the leadership of campus life wanted to hang out at Terry's place, and they would come over there, and my friend, he would come home from construction, and at that time, they have a fifth of beer, you know, they have something to cool off. That was his thought, was really, really good. He says, I worked all day on the hot. He worked at the lumber yards, and he needed something to refresh him. And he came, and I says, he came up to me, and he goes, what problem do you have that with me? Because I'm not getting drunk. Christians could certainly drink. I says, you know, you can't drink if you're going to live in this place because there's kids that come in here. And soon as they open up that refrigerator, because you can't keep kids out of your refrigerator. If you ever had kids go over, the first thing they go say, hey, let's see what he's eating. Let's see what's going on there. Maybe we could steal a Coke out of the house or something. And I told him that he would have to leave if he didn't stop drinking, because we're an example to him. And I want to be an example to kids my whole life, an example of what I'm doing, because I don't want to be brought underneath the power of any. I want to be underneath the power of the Holy Spirit. If something's going to influence me, let God influence me, and not alcohol. And I didn't mean to get on that bent, but as I see this story that's before us, is that we see how he loses his sense of judgment, even as people who do go underneath alcohol. And I know a lot of guys would say to me, say, well, Terry, all I have is one drink. And I normally say, uh-huh. You know, that's how what they normally say, because one drink leads to two drinks, it leads to three drinks. Before you know it, you have a party, you have a big party, and as you're drinking, and all of a sudden say, hey, man, this has been so great. I got my wife over there. She's something to look at. Let's have her come on over. Let me show off to her. Something that he would never do in his right mind, that alcohol empowered him to do that. And so the king, because of being in a state of drunkenness, is angered, it tells us. He's upset that she would not obey the commandment to come before him. And we know the Persian kings, of course, in our story, in our study of other books in Daniel, they were pretty high rulers, and they weren't used to anybody saying no to them. Later on, as we get further along in the book of Esther, remember the story of Mordecai. Mordecai suggested Esther go speak to the king and speak in the defense of his people. And she says, look, you just don't know, go in and see him at your own wish. You don't upset the king. And also, as we know, that if I don't go in and if he doesn't raise his golden scepter, what will happen to me? Off comes the head. I thought about that a little bit today, and I think I was talking to Mesa about it. I mean, when you think about that, how somebody would behead somebody else, that's barbaric. That would never happen in our society. Unfortunately, that was on all over the news just a few years ago, where it still happens, and they were used to that. And the Persian king was now nobody to mess with, but Vashti had the courage to say no. Are not going to be used for that. According to Josephus, those fellows, you know, that we mentioned there, and we got to get in verse 14 that we'll have to look at here in a minute. Really, the idea is they kept on coming. They kept on knocking on her door. They kept on demanding that she comes in and presents herself before the king. And so verse 13, he says, then the king said to the wise men, which knew the times, for so was the king's manner to all the new laws and judgments. Otherwise, they knew what they could do. And I'll let you read those names in verse 14 and verse 15. What shall we do of the queen Vashti? According to the law, because she has not performed the commandments of the king Ahasuerus by the chamberlains. And Mechamam answered before the king and the princesses, Vashti, that queen, had done wrong in the king to the king only, but also to the princesses and to all the people that are all of the provinces of King Ahasuerus. For this deed of the queen shall come abroad unto all women, so they shall despise their husband in their eyes when it shall be reported. And the king Ahasuerus commanded Vashti the queen to be brought in before him, but she came not. So he said, look, this is serious. These guys realized that they didn't deal with her, they didn't deal, take care of her. When they went home and word got back to the other women that the king rebelled against them, what were they concerning? They're going to have trouble when they get back home. And they were really trying to put down the first women's lib movement that there was. And I think it's fascinating that they did this. We got to do something drastic. Lord, I mean, they were calling their Lord, the king, we need to stop this. Verse 18, likewise shall the ladies of Persia and Media say to this day unto all the king's princesses, we have heard of the deed of the queen. Thus shall there arise too much contempt and wrath. And it pleased the king to let there go a royal commandment from him, and let it be written among the laws of the Medes and the Persians, or the Persians and the Medes, that it be not altered, that Vashti come no more before the king Ahasuerus, and let the king give her a royal state unto another that is better than she. We know in history that the laws of the Medes and the Persians could not change. Remember in Darius, and as we talked about in Daniel, when the king Darius signed a decree, and where nobody could pray unto anybody else, nobody could do anything. They passed the law, and he had his ring, and he put it in a place. He stamped to it. Now, what do we find about old Daniel? What did he do? He went and prayed normally. And it really brought, at this point time, Darius to his knees to call to the Lord, because he realized once that edict was put in place, there was no way it could be broken. And these guys knew it. They knew that we could take care of this matter. And of course, we know from the history that of this period of time, this poor king, when he would sober up, he probably would miss his wife. It's something, like I said, he wouldn't do underneath his normal thinking. But from the alcohol and from really these chamberlains, which was his counsel, they encouraged him. He says, we got to lay the law down. And of course, when he started listening to them, standing up to them and saying that's not right, he put that stamp on there. And no matter what he might felt a couple weeks later or a month later, it wasn't going to be changed. In verse 20, and when the king's decree, which he shall make, shall be published throughout all the empire, for it's great, remember the size, all the wives shall give to their husbands honor, both great and small. They didn't have to worry about an uprising. They didn't have to worry about the women getting out of line. And so we understand what's going on here in chapter 1. He says, and the saying pleased the king and the princesses. And the king did according to the words of Merican. And he sent a letter unto all the king's provinces and to every province according to the writing thereof, and every people after their language, and every man should bear the rule of his own house, that it should be published according to the language of every people. So throughout these, 123 provinces, this decree was written in every language, so everybody had a total line. And now they have Vashti as their example. If you don't line up with what the king had to say, you will suffer the consequences. And I think this is interesting as we start painting here tonight. And I would encourage you, that's about all the farther we're going to go, because we've got an exciting events happening in chapter 2 and chapter 3 next week as we really get into the story. Right now, these first three chapters are just real background as we'll take a look at it. Why is all this happening? Is there something that's going to come through this? We all know the story. At least I hope you do. If you don't, read ahead this week. There's a young girl that's going to come. That's going to rise on the scene. At this point, she's just being a young girl, just about her life. But God had a purpose that he's doing, going to work through her. The last couple Sunday mornings, we've been talking about, out of the book of Acts, how James was beheaded and Peter continued on and was released from prison. And we've been talking about how God has given to all of us a destiny, and with that destiny is a responsibility to serve the Lord with all of our hearts, all of our soul, and all of our might. As we see the example of Jesus, as I mentioned this morning, where Jesus, we find him at 12 years old. Where did we find Jesus? Back at the temple. The story is his family had come there, and they headed back to home, back up to Nazareth. And as the whole caravan was leaving, somebody finally looked around and said, oh, anybody see where Jesus is? Oh, isn't he around? As they're traveling, you could lose a little 12-year-old. He's out playing or doing something, throwing some stones or whatever he would do as a 12-year-old. But Mary and Joseph lost their boy. Have you ever lost your kid or had that feeling? I imagine that gripped their heart like, oh, my goodness. And they went running back to Jerusalem. And the last place they were probably thinking that they would find Jesus was where? At the temple. And, of course, I imagine they're about ready to scold their young boy for leaving. And his response was so classic and so important for us here tonight, where he said, I must be about my Father's business. For us to understand and to know what God would give us to do, we need to be about the Father's business this week. We need to put our hand to the plow and not look back and do the things that God gives us to do, whatever it might be. You say, Terry, I'm not doing much. Well, this young girl, Esther, at this time isn't doing much, is she? But there will be a day and there will be a time that God uses you for his purposes and for his glory. He just wants us to seek him day by day. Why don't we go to the Lord in prayer, and then Ray will come and lead us in a song.